Hi, I'm Tasneem Mehta. I'm the Honorary Director of the Dr. Bhau Dajilat Museum. We have just completed 10 years since the museum first opened to the public after a comprehensive five-year restoration, which happened in 2008. To mark this very special occasion, we have curated a show with 10 of our most talented artists. It has to do with the environment and with environmental degradation. It looks at the idea of nature, where we started out as a natural history museum, and today our engagement with the city, with the environment around us, and what are the issues that compel our attention.
So the idea was to ask artists to go back to the original intention of the museum and also addresses the issues that have been faced today. So now there's a big debate about Anthropocene, the so-called geological age that kind of having an impact on today's time and today's atmosphere, and the global warming, the rising sea levels, and many issues with the environment. So I think it's a time for the museum to take that step forward and addresses this issue by having a conversation with the existing display of the museum, and also to reinvent the museum's idea itself and to look at how are we going to think about the future forward.
You know, two museum records from 1876 and 1877 of a procurement of a skeleton of a whale, which is intended to be displayed at the entrance of the museum, exactly where Aquasaurus reincarnates in that same space in a kind of skeletal form, I think draws together in some ways to the history of the space itself and some ways about objects entering and exiting museums. I mean, Aquasaurus itself as a form, as an image, came out of these drawings I had made, essentially of vehicles that are violated in riots, and when you know, you have a completely burned down bus or a car, the remaining image is of a fossilized creature almost. So that's where the piece actually began. And from these drawings, which looked brown and fossil-like, when I began to make sculptures, they became white and somewhat playful. And I think this interplay between life and death, between past, present, or perhaps a future, they kind of ask the question whether this is from a real time gone by or are they objects from an unforeseen, unknown future.
So the works that you see on the wall here are initial works. You have a river named Vetarna just above Bombay, and then you have another river by the same name called Vetarni, which is in Odisha. So we have two of these rivers on both sides of India, which I found very fascinating. So it's all about kind of being in one's own filth. So the myth actually says that there are whirlpools within the river, and then if you fall in, there is no rescuer. So I address the Anthropocene through this myth. So mythically, if one looks at that, is there a rescuer? Can we rescue ourselves from the Anthropocene? And then if you are there in the whirlpools, they'll take you down and you come up, you keep bobbing up and down in your old filth. And that is precisely that what we are doing. We don't realize it, whether it's the air pollution in Delhi, whether it's the other pollution in Bombay or the flooding in Mumbai, whatever you might have it, it is all our own filth. It is all our own doing.
Well, there are two works of mine in the show. These are pre-existing works. One of the works, which is called Forest, it is put up like a stage. In fact, there's a curtain which opens on a clearing in a forest, and there are enactments. So we see various events. In one event, there is harnessing of nature, harnessing of light, so which is the aspect which speaks of science. But soon followed with that is that how development and discovery in science can also lead to destruction. Then there is a library gets burnt down. Books are rescued. So if there has been destruction through knowledge, there also will be rejuvenation through knowledge. The other work was shot in Sundarbans, which has the largest mangrove forest in the world. And now, because of the rising sea level, all the islands are threatened by the sea. They get swallowed up. I had seen a documentary by a friend, Pradeep Saha, where there's a man who says, this is my home. And he said, this is the home of my friends. This is the school. This is the tree under which we played as children. But then we see that there's nothing there. He's standing in a boat and there's sea around him. So I said, I want to weave a kind of narrative around him, an imaginative narrative, but in some ways linking him to the real event. So we found the man, he took us in the boat to the same place. What he actually does is that on the seashore, he recreates the village in mud. And as he leaves that place after finishing and describing to us the design of the village, then it's the time for the tide to rise up. And it also sweeps away what he had created as memory.
This body of work titled Hyphenated Lives is really the convergence of an imagined species as hybrids that come where one half comes from each side of countries that are either politically partitioned or in conflict. So whether it's India, Pakistan, Ireland, UK, North Korea, South Korea. National symbols were always meant to sort of unite people from a region or territory, and how do we as humans appropriate these natural forms? So it was really this sort of trying to subvert this appropriation of nature. So besides the hyphenated lives, which are all the drawings that came from the books that are here, banyan tree was a host to another tree, and I replaced that with the devdar tree from Pakistan, and then the lotus, the red, blue, white lotus combined with the jasmine. So they're all terms called lomine, kobgar, and dioyan, and so on. The other piece, which is called Siamese trees, again has the two trees stemming from the same root, alluding to these long histories and completely woven with electric cable.
The fundamental question for me with a lot of my practices is there still room for wonder in the age of the Anthropocene? And I would argue there has to be, and we have to make sure that there is, because wonder celebrates daring as a mode, and wonder walks a very interesting line between the uncanny and the beautiful or the spectacle or whatever it is. So the work is essentially looking at some of those ideas, but also looking at different imaginations of the planet as a whole, as a sphere. The title of the work is Spheres. So it's a wall drawing and a video mapped onto it. So the video is basically shot at a volcanic site in Japan. And so there are three chapters. Each of those is a different site at the same volcanic caldera. But the first is a cone cylinder, which is dormant and dead. The second is a valley. And the third is the actual cloud maker or the live volcano. The wall drawing is actually then a composite of different maps and diagrams of the Earth as it was imagined as a single entity in space. So it's basically putting these two things together, the possible future and mappings of what was imagined to be.
These sculptures are made with objects that I found in the museum itself, from the storage, which is in the zoo. The storage was once used for holding nocturnal animals. What happens is like they kind of take on their form, and then the viewer kind of creates their own narratives around these objects. Every kind of object that we use, and like the kind of scars that the object has, like this visceral kind of memory of the way it's been used and its own memory. You know. Like the watcher, for example, would kind of remind you of maybe a skull or ceremonial mask. And the way it's installed in the museum as well, among these busts, it feels like archaeological object. These objects feel like they've been kind of extracted or excavated from maybe even the future, like, you know, kind of brought in from the future. They have this like a post-apocalyptic kind of aura. So it's almost like kind of bringing these objects that might signify an archive of tomorrow into the sort of framing space of the museum, which kind of gives them that kind of value of being part of an archive, which might belong to the future.
I've shot inside a refrigerator and have made these miniature escalators, which are staged inside the refrigerator. So the process is on different levels, where it starts being from this object that is made and then installed and then taken picture of. So what one sees finally is a frozen frame of an installation. The idea of the escalators, I mean, a common trope in most of these non-spaces. The whole idea of ascending and descending and arriving and landing is also what one is looking at. The idea of Anthropocene becomes like a layer within the work. It is not something that it's trying to address, but it's probably the cause of it. I mean, like in Bombay, we're, you know, we've axed down so many of these trees in Ari, and then you see the Oberoi Mall right next to it. So I think I'm trying to situate the dialogue on Anthropocene through this.
For this show, I'm using old and used cloth, which I collect from my family members. So in a way, it is collaborative work. So I require normally cotton clothes and hosiery material. And for that, especially, I ask for children clothes and then the women saris. It has a beautiful colors, around 375 sculpture I made for this particular work. So normally we try to search outside, but we don't see what we have in front. It was, I feel, a collaborative portrait of my society. Also, it represents a middle-class family lifestyle. It is first time I'm invited for a museum where other objects around my work. So I'm really looking forward for the public response.